So, Mick Hucknall, welcome back to Manchester, and it's a big day for you, isn't it? You're going to get this honorary doctorate in music.
I feel I had a great experience in this city. I had a great education here, and I owe this city a lot. So to be given this is just a supreme honour, and I feel fantastic about it, because Manchester's been good to me.
And you're also going to be coming back for a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Radio Academy.
It doesn't stop, does it? But, again, within my given profession as a singer and composer and recording artist, to get this accolade is a fantastic feeling for me, because it's an achievement. You know, 25 years with Simply Red, and I think to get this honour right now is just wonderful.
Clearly, a Lifetime Achievement Award doesn't mean that it's over, because you're only just beginning now with this new solo career. A new era for you, really, isn't it, this?
Yeah, it's a sort of a new beginning. You know, I'm not expecting the success that we had with Simply Red, but I'm starting out with smaller venues, and the aim is to kind of build up a following of this music and see where it takes me.
American Soul is out on Monday, your new album. What inspired you to do that?
Well, I started recording in 2011 an album of original material, and during that time I received several invitations from various people to get up and do a bit of singing. It's good for a singer to keep his chops in, you know, keep the old vocal cords in good nick. So I went out to Amsterdam and sang with Bill Wyman's Rhythm Kings, singing a couple of R&B songs with him. Then later I was invited by Ronnie Wood to stand in for Rod Stewart at a charity concert at the Albert Hall. And then they invited me to tour with them. And I was singing a couple of R&B songs with them, one of them which was I'd Rather Go Blind, which is on the album. And then latterly, I was invited by Charlie Watts to sing with his ABCD band of Boogie Woogie R&B songs again. And I enjoyed it so much. My manager said, "You really enjoyed that, didn't you?" And it was great. And so we decided, he said, "Why didn't you make an album of it?" So while I was making the originals album, I also interspersed with one or two takes of these, and we ended up making two albums at the same time. So that we have American Soul, and then the originals album will come out after that.
And these are songs that really mean something to you through your life, and one of them, I think you sang back in Denton, didn't you?
I didn't actually sing the song back in Denton, but the history of it is quite amusing for me, that I used to be a waiter in a working men's club in Denton. And on Saturday and Sunday nights they'd have turns on, and these artists would sing some of these old crooning songs. And this song, It's Impossible, which is on the album, was one of the songs that they used to sing. And it always reminds me of my time as a waiter in a working men's club.
And I think you've said as well that some of these songs have been quite difficult, quite complex, haven't they, to sing?
The one that's particularly challenging to sing on the album is I Only Have Eyes For You. It's got long, sustained notes, and they're the hardest thing to do, really, in singing. To keep them, you know, to breathe in is one of the big issues. And I've always avoided vibrato as well, which is I always think is a bit of a cop-out. So this song is really about holding long, sustained notes all the way through the song. So that's what the challenge is, really, with this song, I Only Have Eyes For You.
The single out on Monday, that's an Otis Redding classic, isn't it?
Well, I'm familiar with versions. The versions that I know of is the version by O.V. Wright, Otis's version, and a great version by the Rolling Stones. Mick Jagger's vocal on that is really, really nice. So those are the three that I'm most familiar with. I've always loved the song. It's been with me since I was a teenager.
So you'll obviously be concentrating on the tour and promoting this new album and single. What's on the horizon after that, or haven't you thought about that yet?
Well, as I said, we actually made two albums at the same time. What I see happening with that is that there will just be a natural crossover into the next album. Because we're going to be up and running and touring. Next year, with the shows, you know, I'll be playing most of the songs from this album. Probably play one or two new songs. I'll probably play a couple of Simply Red songs as well, just to keep everybody happy. And that's really going to be the nature of the show next year.
Finally, I would imagine the newspaper article today, is, as always, has been taken out of context, but they're suggesting that you had a talent show turned down by the BBC, and it was they chose The Voice instead. I mean, was that the case?
Well, it sort of was the case, actually, yeah, because I made a, they call it a pitch, I think, that we made a pitch with a company that specialised in doing these programmes for the idea of making a show looking for the next creative artist. Well, unfortunately, it was turned down, but, you know, the Voice was a big show, so I presume they're happy with that. I've no idea.
Finally then, as you are a doctor of music now, what would be your advice then to an up-and-coming new artist?
Well, I would say that at the moment it's very difficult for an artist who writes their own songs to compete with these talent shows, because the amount of coverage they get on mainstream TV, there isn't even really a major company that compete with that kind of level of publicity. So the solution would be is to have a programme that is trying to find the next Lennon and McCartney, the next Jagger Richards, the next David Bowie, Freddie Mercury, Elton John, the people that made this country famous the world over for creative music. At the moment, we don't have anything like that. The only sort of shining beacon on television that represents it is that it's a great Jules Holland show. But, you know, we're looking for something that will find mainstream artists. You know, I present the scenario like this. Imagine if you had one of these fly-in-the-wall cameras that they have on these talent shows. It goes into somebody's bedroom and they start recording and they say, oh, tell us your name and tell us the name of the song. My name's David Bowie and this song's called Space Oddity. Now, can you imagine the thrill that we would get as a nation of finding an artist like that? There's no reason why we can't find an artist like that. But at the moment, there's no outlet to even get the chance to find an artist like that. There's no program. I think it's extraordinary after all these years that they haven't developed that. And that's really what I was trying to push for, because I think they're out there and we just have to try and nurture them and find them.
Mick Hucknall, congratulations on this new album. I think already it's been critically acclaimed as something outstanding. So good luck with the tour, good luck with the single and the album.
Well, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure talking to you.